Hello everyone, I'm Tim from Tim Does Level Design and welcome to lesson 8 of my beginner course in video game level design. As homework from the previous lesson, you should have iterated on area 1, the woods, to a point where you're at least quite happy with the way it plays, and have set up the other areas of the level to a point where they roughly reflect the intended size, shape, and give an indication of the intended gameplay. In this lesson, I'd like to talk about level art and the role that a level designer plays in this. On YouTube, one of the most popular categories of level design related videos is known as speed level design. However, it's important to note that these videos have virtually nothing to do with level design. In the industry, this is generally referred to as level art or level dressing, which is more often than not handled by someone in a level artist position rather than by a level designer. Though when I did my level design internship on March of War back in 2012, our level design team was actually also responsible for dressing our own levels, with some input and guidance from the art department. And especially in smaller game studios, it's still possible for this responsibility to fall onto level designers. Looking at blockout clips from Jedi Fallen Order by Respawn Entertainment, we can see a very gameplay-centric approach, where the blockout gameplay is finely tweaked, but visually, there's still only a very rough representation of the visual intention. The final results after the artists have had their hands on it, in this case, is still almost exactly one-to-one to the delivered blockout. Whereas on a project like Star Wars Outlaws, we'd start iterating together with the level artists way earlier and go through many passes where the layout would still change drastically after initial level art passes. For our platformer project, I don't want to dive in too deep into actual level art, but touch on how as level designers, we can already take the aesthetic of the level into account during early stages, how we can represent visual elements, and how the art side of things can also affect our level design. So our characters and gameplay all take place on a 2D plane, not unlike other platformer games such as Hollow Knight. Though despite some elements of our game consisting of 2D pixel art, let's assume our environments will be comprised of a completely 3D space, similar to, for example, Prince of Persia: The Lost Crown, which can be an excellent game for us to use as reference. In our content folder, we can find a folder called LD_dressing_meshes. Here I've added a couple of simple prototype meshes that we can use for the forest area to try and give it a bit of visual depth and character. Let's drag a ground tile into our map, scale it a bit, duplicate it, and use it to flank our path. To keep things organized, I'll make sure all dressing assets are sorted in a folder I'll call LD_dressing. I'll dot around some fir trees and bushes in this area as well, varying the scaling and rotation a bit where needed. And as we can see, this slowly starts adding some depth already, and giving a hint of the area theme. As a level designer, it's important to put yourself in the shoes of your player as much as possible, and when we take a holistic approach, we can realize that a good level isn't just about interesting mechanical challenges. In our QDD, we can see that the player has just finished a cinematic in which they enter the thematic area of the woods. So instead of immediately throwing the player into a new gameplay challenge, perhaps it's better for us to create a little bit of space here. This gives them some time to reflect on what happened in the cinematic and take in their new surroundings, possibly accompanied with a new soundtrack as well. This doesn't mean, however, that we absolutely can't give the player anything to do at this stage. But when providing a challenge, it might be best to start the player off easy, before introducing the more challenging, thought-provoking obstacles. This balancing of action, challenges, and story moments is in what in game design we refer to as pacing. If you'd like to learn more about pacing, a while back I made a video on that specific topic, which you can find on my YouTube channel. I'll add a combination of bushes and trees at the start, with a bit of a hole to represent a dense forest the player emerges from during the cutscene. I'm trying not to overdo it with the amount of assets used here and time spent, as the more detailed this becomes, the more painful it's going to be when you realize it really should be changed again, which is always a possibility in level design. These assets do not have collision setup, by the way, so I'll add an angle of solid wall here that's obscured by the foliage to prevent the player from backtracking. taking some reference from Ori and the Will of the Wisps forest areas and its massive trees. From the quick add drop-down menu, I'll add a cylinder to our map. I'll make sure it's sorted in the dressing folder, and under Content, Materials, Dressing, I can find some plain colored materials to use for our prototype dressing assets. I'll use these cylinders to build a rough representation of a large tree trunk. Maybe I can use one of the existing tree trunk assets to lend some credibility to it. And what if these obstacles on the side aren't part of the ground, but are actually extended spiky roots or tree branches? I can duplicate some simple cubes to try and represent the root of a tree. Though in some cases, you might want a little bit more control over your blockouts and might even want to create your own prototype meshes. Generally, the 3D objects in video games, whether it's the final polished assets or some early placeholders for testing, are created with dedicated 3D modeling software. Programs like 3ds Max and Maya used to be the most commonly used tools. But for the past 10 years or so, the 3D modeling software called Blender has gained ground, and the last few years has overtaken them completely in popularity. As an open source tool, Blender is completely free, and due to its popularity, you can find a vast amount of tutorials and documentation to learn how to use it. Though in most video game productions, 3D assets are built by dedicated 3D artists, in some level design jobs, you are still expected to have some rudimentary 3D modeling skills to set up your level blockouts. Luckily for us, since a couple of years, Unreal Engine features its very own in-engine modeling mode. We won't do a deep dive into this, as there's a ton of learning resources out there. But let's use our tree root as an example and have a brief look at some of its functionality, as it can be a useful tool to improve our blockouts and quickly create some placeholder assets. To get started with Unreal Engine's modeling mode, in a main toolbar above our viewport, we need to switch from our default selection mode to modeling mode. If this doesn't show up for you or is unavailable, you'll need to go to your Plugins tab in your project settings, search for Modeling, and toggle on the Modeling Tools Editor mode to enable it. When enabling it for the first time, you'll need a quick engine restart. With Modeling Mode enabled, when we navigate to the Create tab, we can choose a basic shape or method as a starting point. For our tree root, I'll select a cylinder, as it's likely the closest shape to what we need. When we move our mouse around our viewport, we see the cylinder snapping to geometry wherever we move it. Let's click near where we're going to want the tree root to start to anchor it in place. Now before we actually create a mesh, in the contextual menu on the left, we can first change some parameters. I'll increase the radius to 100 and reduce the height to 100, as our tree root should start wider and then get narrower. As meshes don't have true roundness, but are essentially made up of triangles, the more slices we add, the closer to roundness our cylinder gets, but the more demanding it will be for a computer to render it. For our prototype purpose, a simple 8 radial slices will do the trick. For our material, I'll search for and use basic brown. Before pressing accept to create a mesh, let's select where it's going to be saved. Under Modeling Mode Quick Settings, we can change the new asset location to Current Folder. And in our Content Browser, navigate to our LD_DressingMeshes folder. When we're happy with our set parameters, we can press Accept, which will create the cylinder mesh for us. In our Content Browser, we can see that our new cylinder has been added, which allows us to reuse it anywhere we like by dragging it into our viewport. While we're in modeling mode, we can select our cylinder asset in viewport again, and this time go over to the Model tab. When we select Polygroup Edit and mouse over our mesh, we can see that we can select various faces of the mesh that are grouped together. With the face selected, the tool will give us various handles that we can use to change the face's location, size, rotation, and scale. I'll scale and angle it a bit to go in the desired direction. We'll want to extend our root into the desired direction, so I'll make sure the forward facing face is selected, and I'll press the extrude button. We can now move our mouse to pull this face out of the existing mesh, and left click to confirm. With a new face, we again have all the handles available to modify the size, rotation, and location. Then we can extrude again, modify again, rinse and repeat, until we have a shape that's approximately what we want. After pressing accept, we can still go back into polygroup edit and continue shaping the mesh to our liking by selecting and modifying various faces and edges. This is just a small snippet of the vast array of things Unreal Engine's modeling mode can do, and just functions as a very brief introduction. I can highly recommend looking up dedicated documentation and tutorials about this powerful feature that can really help you up your blockout game, like this extensive overview by SARKAMARI on YouTube. In addition to Unreal Engine's modeling tool, there are various ways of finding and getting 3D models into your project. For example, itch.io has a vast collection of both free and paid assets that you can use in your projects. I used various free 2D sprite assets from itch.io to set up this platformer game project. In addition to the larger communities, some individual creators like KenneyNL also make available a ton of free prototype assets for creators to use. As a test, let's download this graveyard kit. We'll extract the zip and navigate to the FBX folder. In our Unreal project, I'll create a new folder in our dressing meshes folder where we can import them. And then we can simply select everything and drag them from our file explorer into the folder in our Unreal project. In this case, we can leave all import settings as they are by default. I'll just set the import uniform scale to 1.5, as I found the assets to be a bit small for our project. After it's all done importing, we now have a ton of new assets we can simply drag and drop into our map to use for dressing. And we can use them to give some character and depth to our existing blockouts, like our graveyard area. It's also worth taking a look at everything that's on offer on Epic's own marketplace. When we open the Epic Games Launcher, under Unreal Engine, we can navigate to the Marketplace tab. Each month, Epic Games pays creators to give away their creations for free for a limited time. In addition, there's also a permanently free collection of various different creations you can use in your projects. Let's select one, add it to our cart, and check it out for free. When we've purchased it for free, we can now find it in our vault, under the Library tab, and easily add it to our project. When it's finished importing, we have even more assets available to spruce up our map. But please be cautious not to add too much visual detail too early. When dressing a scene too early or too detailed, it makes it incredibly tedious to make changes to your layout, which would have been very quick to iterate on in simple blockout form. It's also in most cases not the level designer's role to dress up your own blockout levels. So while it can't hurt to practice with this, it's not where your main emphasis should be on. For this lesson's homework, I'd like you to try implementing some rudimentary placeholder art for your most fleshed out area, the forest. Don't go too far with it, just focus on some simple key elements that can help communicate the setting and overall feeling of the space a bit better. In addition, it couldn't hurt to apply the learnings from the previous lessons to your other areas as well, and push your overall map quality one step closer to the finish line. Please do like and subscribe, and hit that notification bell below to get notified when the next video goes live. Thank you very much for watching, and see you in the next video.